Good evening, everyone. My name is Nick Rizzo. I'm the Guidance Department Chair, and I'd like to welcome all of you to College Planning Night. We're eager to get started and talk a little bit. We've got a panel discussion with some representatives from some area colleges, but first I'd like to give kind of a very quick overview of a couple of things and go into the Nomians program. First off, what I'd like to say, though, as far as some quick housekeeping items, restrooms, if you walk out of the auditorium, turn to the right, and then quickly around the corner to the right, the restrooms are right there. And then also, we mailed out a packet just before the break. Everyone should have received that right over break, and there was a lot of good college planning items in there, along with some information about the National College Grant that's coming up. If you did not, for whatever reason, receive those items, we have most of them. We're going to be putting them out on the table after the presentation is over, so if for whatever reason you don't have those and you'd like to pick up an extra copy, we have them right there. Now, the first thing that I would like to say is that one of the things that we're most passionate about is working with students for college planning. And we're looking forward to wrapping up scheduling. We're just about done with the scheduling process for next year. And as soon as we wrap that up, we really do kind of dive into college planning. That's something that we'll be doing throughout the month of March and April. So we'll be meeting with your son or daughter individually. The counselors will be calling every student down. We'll be meeting with them individually to go over where they're at, what they need to be doing, where they need to be going, all of that kind of stuff. We send little green passes for everybody. Occasionally it might happen where they might not get the pass, or might not be a convenient time for them. We encourage them, if they don't get a pass, if they want to get the jump on it, don't wait for the green pass, come and make an appointment with us. Also, we're here as a resource for you guys. If there is something that you have a question with, don't hesitate to email us, don't hesitate to call us. We're planning, like I said, meeting with all of the juniors this spring, then we plan on individually meeting with all of the seniors in the fall. We'll also be doing a sort of a classroom type presentation for all of them at the beginning of the school year that will go over the college application process. But if you feel like you need more assistance than what we're providing initially, it's kind of a la carte. Take what you need. We're here to help you, and we're excited to do that. We don't know exactly what you might need, because every student is at a slightly different spot in the process. So take advantage of whatever it is that you need in our services. The one thing that I would say right now that we're going to get into is the Nomians program. And that's really, I think, a very good jumping off point for the college application process and sort of narrowing the list of schools and researching schools, really. When you're looking at trying to narrow things down, there's over 5,000 schools that are out there that you might have an opportunity to try and take a look at. There's no way that you can call through all 5,000 schools. It's simply impossible. So you've got to try to narrow the process, and there's all kinds of search engines and things that are out there. This is what we kind of subscribe to, and it's to me, I think, a very good search engine to narrow things based on specific criteria. But then what's really good is you can look at each school, and it strips down the school based on some important criteria that school has. Maybe say their admissions criteria, some of their financial aid information, some of their major information. All of that stuff you can easily locate. If you were to go to 10 different college websites, it might the same information that you're looking for might be in 10 different spots. So if you're looking through the Nomians program, it's going to be a little bit easier because it's all in one same similar standardized format. So you're going to kind of know where to go. Then once you've kind of gotten the lay of the land for some of the colleges, you're able to then go to the websites, because their individual websites are a tremendous resource, but it can be a little bit overwhelming at first. That's why I recommend starting here. So just to give you an idea. Easiest way to get to Nomians is to go to our website, which is clarenceschools.org. You would go to high schools, and then from there you would go to guidance and counseling, and we've got a drop down right here. You would click on Nomians, and then from there it's going to take you to a login screen, and that's not what I needed. There you go. It's going to take you to a login screen, and the login is going to be your student's parent portal information, and that information was given to them in case they didn't have it, put it to them in a red folder when we did the PSAT interpretation back in December. So if they don't have it, they're not sure of it, they can stop down to our office, we'll print out a sheet and give it to them so that they're able to log in. This is the login screen with what it looks like when you log in. They're able to access their transcripts right here just simply by clicking on this, or you could also go to, let's see, About Me. And clearly I didn't place this projector in a very accessible spot for me, but just have to bear with it, run with it, I suppose. It would be About Me, and then, yeah, Documents, Transcript. So you would go there and you'd be able to access your transcript. Now, the transcript is not right now a live document. It's more a snapshot in time. And that's something that if you've got recruiting purposes or you want to go to a college and have them look over the transcript while you're there visiting, that's what you would bring along with you. But if, again, keep in mind it's not a live document. The live transcript, the official six-semester transcript that encompasses their through their junior year, that will not be ready until probably, I would say, the beginning of September, but then with the rank will not be ready until October 1st of senior year. But we'll have an unranked transcript ready at the beginning of the school year. All right? Now, when it comes to the search process, it's pretty easy to play around with this. This might help and be a little less awkward for everyone, including me. Okay. You would go to College Search. There's a range of criteria here that you could look through. And then say you did find a college that you were pretty interested in, you could add it to your list of colleges I'm thinking about. So it's going to keep a running list for you. It's a nice way to kind of keep things organized. Say you were interested in, say, Buffalo State College. This is what every single school has, and this is sort of the same layout. It's going to give you the enrollment figures. It's going to give you some admissions information. It's going to give you financial aid information, majors, and then what I really like about it, what to me I think is most helpful, is you're able to see the school stats for Clarence High School. So, you know, when you look at admissions information right here, you can see that it's, you know, all the students from all over the country that might have applied, 12,000, 61% were accepted. That is helpful in sort of a general way, but how does it compare to Clarence students? How have Clarence students done at a particular school? And you're able to get that by going to this graph right here. And this graph is a data point of all the students who applied in the last couple of years, and this is SATs along the bottom, and then GPA along this axis right here. And it's going to give you a pretty nice idea of whether or not you're going to be able to get into the school or not. I guess I don't want to say whether or not you'll definitely be able to get into the school. It's more just kind of a general sense. Because you have to keep in mind, in every single school year, the admissions process is a little bit different. Some years are a little bit stronger on the admissions side, some years are a little bit weaker. So a student might have gotten in one year, might not the next, and vice versa. Okay? So that's something that's important to keep in mind. Also, along the side right here, we've got a lot of helpful links that you can get into. And then outside of that, I would just like to point out that, okay, on our website, we do have some good stuff for college planning, and I guess I would say that's maybe a little bit of a misnomer. It's not exactly college planning right now. We're still adding things to it, but we do have a lot here on the college application process that was very relevant to this year. I did a couple of screencasts. There's about, let's see, I think this is about a maybe 10-minute screencast on the overall application process and what's involved. This is 10 minutes on the Naviance process, because students will actually resubmit the students' applications through the Naviance program. And it's something that they'll end up using next year. So I don't want to get into too much of that right now, but this explains a little bit more of it. And then this also right here is a 10-minute screencast on the Common application. And then this is about a 60-page packet on the college application process. So there's a lot of, I think, pretty helpful and important stuff there that you can take a look at your convenience, whenever you need to. Right? So with that said, I would like to just start with the panel discussion. So I'll ask our panelists to take a seat, and we'll get going. I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Gardner, who's going to be our moderator.
coming out. We've done this many, many times, although we've done a whole lot of different formats. This seems to be the format that over the last 4 or 5 years has worked the best for us. But I would definitely encourage you, as we try to give you information, I think you can imagine in 1 hour there's no way we can really give you everything. We're going to try to highlight some of the facts and figures and thoughts and experience that we've had doing this. But if anything pertinent to your situation or just that you wonder and we didn't answer it throughout that hour, we'd be happy to have you ask that question for us. We'll get right into it. On our by far right, we're going to have panelists that have been with us quite some time and have a ton of admissions experience. Chris, if you want to introduce yourself from Niagara, and we'll kind of go right along and we'll introduce each other.
I'm the Senior Associate Director at Niagara University's Admissions Office. I've been there forever. So just to let you know that at Niagara, we're a 4-year private Catholic university. We have 5 academic divisions at the university: arts and science, business education, hospitality and tourism management, and my all-for-all favorite is the academic exploration program for students who are like me, maybe knowing they want a 4-year degree, but can't pin down which 4-year degree they want. We have about 3,200 undergraduate students at the university. We have about 914 graduate students, because we do have some graduate programs and a PhD program as well. We do find that our students come from all over New York State, New Jersey, Connecticut, Pennsylvania, Ohio. We've been seeing the trend from California, so I decided that they are either displaced Western New Yorkers, from just the weather that we're having tonight, or they're tired of the earth moving under their feet, so they're moving out in our direction. So we find that our students enjoy the campus life. We do require community service as part of the undergraduate curriculum here with us. So we have about 100 different clubs and activities. We're a D1 sports program and many different sports and endeavors, but not everybody is wanting to play D1, so we have a wide range of extracurricular and club sports. I'm Irish and Italian and can go on forever, but I'm going to hand it over so we can move on to the meat. But any questions after, I'd be most happy to answer for you.
Good evening. How's everybody? Good, all right? Yeah, I drove here from like super, super far away. No, just kidding. Thank you all for having me here. I did wear my red in honor of, where I am. Clarence, that's okay, is that right? The way you feel, people were really upset about it, but I said, no, Clarence is more important to me tonight. It just turned out I actually had a meeting, and ECC's color is red too, so I was like, you're very ECC. I was like, I'm also very Clarence tonight. So I've been here for quite a few years, and I'm very thankful to have you back. I don't know why you have me back, but I appreciate it. But my name is Eric DeGuino. I'm the Associate Vice President for Enrollment Management at Erie Community College. What does that mean? That means I oversee admissions, registration, financial aid, counseling, a few of the departments are to be involved in the institution. I was director of admissions for about 3 years, and then prior to that, I was a UB for 9 years. So I do have a very long history within higher education, and I do love it. A little bit about ECC. ECC is obviously a community college. We have 3 campuses. We have one not too far away from here, Williamsville. We have one downtown, and we also have one at South Campus right across from our office, the stadium. I've worked at all the campuses, and we have over 90 degree programs. A couple things. First and foremost, ECC is an open access institution. By nature, we're here to be able to provide education to anybody within Erie County and beyond. Okay? As long as they have the ability to benefit from school. Okay? That's fantastic. So anybody who applies, graduated from high school, can come to ECC. We have a wide variety of students who come to ECC. Students who are trying to build a portfolio to transfer on to fantastic institutions like Niagara. So you basically have 2 paths, which most people are aware of, the path to transfer on to a 4-year school. But we also have an equal path of preparation for jobs right out of ECC. So we have a whole career technical aspect. Most common you would find, nursing, okay? Train you right there, 2-year RN, go right up. So that's an important distinction I'd like to point out to students and parents when you're looking at the college, is that we have the career path and then the transfer path. Other things aside from nursing, we have a number of health science options, A lot of programs in the technologies, nanotechnology, something in biomanufacturing, all designed to get students jobs right after they finish their associate's degree. One thing you'll find at community college is the highest degree will get a two-year associate's degree, whereas our four-year partners have four-year bachelor's degrees. And we also have athletics. As I'm sure, was everybody aware that last year we had the national champion hockey team? Who's aware of that? Anybody?
One of them.
A couple. Great. And we're actually in the national championship tournament again this year. And anybody follows bowling, which I admittedly do not, but Mike Simonelli, who I think he came in second in the PBA championship, he's a graduate of ECC as well. So we have a lot of great programs. Our football program is doing well. And a lot of our students, student athletes, use the junior college programs to springboard into Division I institutions. So very proud of that. I could go on, but I shall stop for now.
I wish you were here earlier, probably 4 or 5 years ago. Eric was so shy, he would never come out of his shell, so he's really come a long way.
Experience in terms of this process, in the fact that I kind of went on my own tour of Western New York colleges as a college student. So the majority of schools in this area I have been to in a matriculating capacity, and can hopefully use that to help kids kind of understand how this process works and what most of these schools are like when they'll experience that themselves.
As I mentioned, I'm Nick Rizzo, and as we're looking for kind of diversity of panelists, Andy has bounced around a little bit, pretty much one school, that's it, and then got here, and I've been here for 15 years, did my internship here, so pretty stable experience. So a little bit different than Andy, but I think we'll bring a lot to the table admissions-wise, so that's it. And
Mr. Rizzo had mentioned earlier, there's probably about 5,000 2-4-year colleges out there. So one of the things is, okay, where do I start? How do I narrow that down to a manageable number and then ultimately pick one of them? Maybe Mr. Steger can just talk a little bit about the factors that a student would use to try to help find schools.
There are some major factors that are over.
Wait, stop the presses. SUNY Geneseo is in the bag.
Apologize, everyone.
So punctuality of admission perhaps is number one.
I'll let Chris get settled, but Chris is from SUNY Geneseo and we'll work him into the conversation.
There are a number of factors that play into choosing a school, and those factors, for the most part, can differ from student to student based on interest, based on experience, based on their future plans. Some of the major factors that come into play for most kids are things like, obviously, major. The field of interest that they have as far as studying at the four-year or two-year institution. Location, whether kids want to stay close to home, whether they want to stay by mom and dad, because mom and dad are spoiled and taking care of them, or whether they want to go far away from mom and dad as possible. That is a big factor for kids. The size of the school is important. Do they want a smaller school? Do they want to feel like family, know everybody, have that comfort? Or do they want that big college experience where they go to football games in big stadiums and there are hundreds of kids in some classes, and that, that big experience that, as much as we think Clarence is a huge school, they really can't get at the high school level. Those are some of the things that might matter individually to your sons and daughters.
Anybody else want to chime in?
The only thing I guess I would add is that, you know, what you think you might want might not be what you end up wanting, which really, and I'm sure we're going to talk a little bit about the college visit, but that really underscores the importance of getting on campuses and seeing what each college is like. And we've got a wealth of Western New York colleges. And even if you think you want to go 4 hours away, I would suggest going and visiting some of our local schools, because you've got a large public school right here in our backyard in UB. You've got Niagara, that's smaller private school. You've got Canisius, that's smaller private school in an urban setting. So you've got schools in a lot of different settings. Try out the settings, and then you can sort of generalize that to some of the schools out of our areas that you might be looking at, and it would, I would say, save you a lot of time and money and travel and that kind of thing. You might certainly be surprised at some of the schools that you might not have considered before. Wow, Canisius is a school I would have considered, or Niagara's a school I would have considered. Those are things that really can be a great benefit to just kind of looking in your own backyard to see what you might want in a college. And it really could change. I've had a lot of students that looked at a lot of different types of schools and what they started out thinking they wanted ended up being very, very different than what they ended up settling on and applying to.
And over that, because as a mother who's gone through this process twice already, daughter was the easy one, the son was all over the place. We did visit many, many colleges, and what he thought he wanted wasn't where he ended up, but it ended up being a good decision. So it's just those who are here, how many here now are juniors? How many are sophomore? Okay, so it's more a junior group than seniors. So no, as you start the process, and we started in the junior year, just like you guys are all doing, the more time you have, the more worthwhile it's going to be. You're going to be able to get a little bit more. This area has a wealth of opportunities in terms of colleges. And I get into what you said, because I'm originally from the Long Island, New York area. Down there, it's the same deal. There's lots of colleges right down there. Here is the same deal. So it's a nice wealth of opportunities. So start to look around, and then continue to branch out your search.
That's part of why we wanted some of the diverse schools, is just to kind of offer that. But what's nice about it is their perspective is more than just the school that they work at. They really do have a working knowledge of really all the different options. Can you talk a little bit? I mean, when we bring up the factors, I think what's important to know is we try to use those factors as probably the most black and white that we can use. How far from home is very black and white. Once a student establishes they want 2, 3, 4 hours away, when you again start at that 5,000 schools, that's very, very easy to then get less than 5,000 because it either is or it isn't. And that's really what I think the starting point does and is trying to kind of work that so that we can get to a number that doesn't seem so intimidating and overwhelming. The major piece is to me by far one of the hardest things, and I really try, and my students I think over the years have gotten to this point too, either on their own or because they stress so much, is that to me is not the be all end all question. Because I think if we all of us that went to college look at, are we in the same major that we went for? How much zigzagging did we do? It's very hard at 18 to really know what you want to do. So I would rather try to find the place that's going to make that person the most confident young woman, young man that they can be, and then figure it out from there. That's really kind of, I think, a little bit of maybe our philosophy, because the major, it's just too hard to really figure that out. Those that know, that's great. But to kind of have that pressure, I think we try to alleviate a little bit. That's not as black and white. That's much more gray. When it comes to visits, that was one thing that kind of came up. Can you talk and take us through a little bit of one of the factors in visiting the school? What does the visit look like? What should they do? And how does that work?
Sure, I'll get started
here. First off, I want to apologize for being late. The roads were pretty treacherous out there. I got stuck behind a semi going 20 miles per hour. So I promise you my ETA was much earlier than a 7 o'clock arrival. But with that said, obviously the college search is an important and imperative piece. And at this point right now, as juniors, you're probably going to get pretty heavily into that. With regards to Geneseo, we try to offer as much as we possibly can regarding visits. I think we offer quite a bit to really get the realm and the scope of what it's like to be a student at Geneseo. Mondays through Saturdays, we offer campus tours, information sessions. Those campus tours typically about an hour and a half in length, given by current Geneseo students. And our information sessions are always given by one of our admissions counselors, typically about 45 minutes to 60 minutes of just A, B, C, D, everything regarding the college search process, everything regarding the academic side of things, everything regarding
clubs, organizations, even everything that makes up Geneseo. Above and beyond that, though, what I think are great opportunities are those schools that offer the ability to do class visits. We also give the opportunity to what we call a day visit, which is the day in the life of a Geneseo student, where we pair you up with a current Geneseo student, hopefully that has and is aligned with your specific major that you're interested in. But you take 4 hours to do an informal campus tour. You go to lunch, you'll check out a res hall, check out the main street, which is connected to SUNY Geneseo. You really, again, just take in the day in the life of a Geneseo student. So again, class visits, day visits, the ability to do the campus tours, information sessions are all something that we provide at Geneseo.
You'll find as you look at colleges, most of us will have similar things, and you can find those all on our websites. Usually we post those. And I look at colleges as you're looking at them, you want one that's going to fit you, kind of like if you're buying your first new car. You wouldn't buy it from someone else, not that make brand or make or model. You would make sure that vehicle fits you like a glove. You want to do nothing less with your college education. You want to visit the school, if it means spending a day like at Geneseo or Niagara or ECC, you would be able to do that. You would be able to kind of check it out. Niagara also offers overnight programs. If you're an applied student or in the spring, you need to be accepted into our program. We provide overnight so you can test drive with IB and live on campus overnight and experience that. We have set up meetings with department chairs, with deans, whomever you need to see or do. Many colleges and universities will be able to accommodate, but you need to call the admissions office and ask each one of those colleges what they're able to do, and that way you'll get the best experience. You want to walk away from your college, if it's the college you think you want to go to, you want to envision yourself there and say, well, this is a place I can see myself studying. Because when it gets hard, you want to be at a place that's comfortable for you.
I always look at it in a few different ways. A lot of people go to open houses. How many people have been to an open house or want to go to an open house? Everybody's hand should be raised. You're going to go to an open house, that's fantastic, okay? Remember, when you go to that open house, each and every one of us from whatever institution is going to do our darndest to make sure that is the best the campus looks that two or three times a year that we have the open house, okay? You have to gauge that as you're going to visit the institution. And then as you get to smaller types of visits, your information sessions, your one-on-ones, that's when you're going to get kind of a more real picture of what life is like there, okay? I feel like students should want to go sit in the class, go see what it's like to be there, and I cannot think of a single institution of higher education that I've ever been a part of or even brushed shoulders against that wouldn't provide you with an opportunity to do that. Because it is about the fit, it's about the feel, okay? As my kids get older, I've been doing these panel presentations for a long time, and I sit there and I always question, like, am I gonna say this when my kids get to this point in time? I'm only a few years away from that. Because I used to say, pick the school that you feel is the best fit for you. Follow your heart. When it comes to academic programs, and parents would kind of shrug or give you kind of an odd look, like, why are you saying this? I would tell students to pick the program that they're going to enjoy doing, okay? Because there's always graduate school, right? So, and parents are like, that's not what you're supposed to say, they're supposed to get a job and get out of my basement. But that's, realistically, you want someplace where you're going to thrive. Now why, okay? Not just because you're going to thrive to have a good time there, but if you're in a comfortable environment, chances are you're going to get higher grades, okay? And if you get higher grades, you're going to be able to get into a great grad school. Chances are that almost any grad program out there, and there are exceptions, but about, large percentage of them, don't require a specific undergraduate major to get into it. Okay? I was a psychology major. My parents said, what are you going to do with that? I was like, don't worry about it, I'll figure it out. And then when I was sitting in a presentation like this, I said, you know what? I want to be an associate vice president for enrollment management. That's what I want to do. You know what I mean? And really, the way it actually happened, how I found my way here, and this is how most people find their careers. Yeah, sounds like that's how you found it. I was sitting in school. I was a psychology major. I was like, you know what? I don't know what I want to do. Coming into my senior year, I was a first generation college student. First one in my family to go to college. I had no idea what I was doing. I was tripping over things. And that's how I found my way. I went to Fredonia as an undergrad. I loved Fredonia. I couldn't have been more thankful for that. Got my master's at Buff State, PhD at UB. Now I'm working at these. So I've seen a lot of these pieces. But when I was a senior, I was like, I don't know what I want to do. Maybe I should go for more education just so I can stay in school. And someone said to me, it seems like you want to stay in school and, you know, you have a bit of a Peter Pan complex and like to have fun. I was like, yeah, I kind of do. And they said, why don't you work at one? I was like, I never thought about that. And so that's how I found my way here, you know? So, but it all started with, I picked the major I enjoyed. That gave me the great grades to be able to pick what master's program I wanted to get into. I loved it. And then it got me into my PhD program, doing my research, and found that this is a field. And I would tell all students as they're going through, because I was an academic advisor for a long time as well, if you pick something that you love, you are going to be fantastic at it. And in today's day and age, there's probably a job. Okay? I was just listening to NPR, which I know sound makes me sound really old, and I was listening to the fact that there's a $1 billion industry in life coaching. Life coaching, okay? Where I just say, no, you're fantastic. Go do the best you can out there. Take money. You know what I mean? In today's day and age, with such specialization, such specificity, you can't pick that right now when you're sitting there. You're coming from an environment where you have 12, 15 different academic choices, and you're going to go into a place where we probably all have at least 80, 90, 100 different academic programs offered. How are you supposed to decide that based on what you know now? Pick what you love, find the right fit, and you're going to thrive. I don't know if that answered your question, but I kind of just wanted to say it. I'm sorry.
While we're off on the sides, to piggyback on Chris's car metaphor from a couple of minutes ago, one thing that I think is really important is for students to make sure that they have a conversation with their parents. Parents to have a conversation with the students about what they want in a college. What do the parents want in a college for their student, and what does the student want in a college from their perspective? And, you know, I'll guarantee you, much like buying a new car, if you were buying a car for your son or daughter, they were buying it themselves, what they would probably list as factors that they want, options that they would want in the vehicle, would be very, very different than options that the parent would want in the vehicle. I'm going to guess the parent would be looking at safety concerns. Students might be looking at what technology integration or guys, maybe how fast the car goes, different things like that. There's a lot of different variables that they'd be looking at. And, you know, the student has to be comfortable where they're going, because very much like what Eric said, if they're not comfortable there, they're probably not going to be doing all that well there. And at the same time, the parent has to be very comfortable. So students, guys, your parents have to be comfortable where they're going to be sending you. They've got to be, you know, comfortable that it's going to be a safe, good environment for you, because their money is going there as well. So you've got to have kind of a partnership there. Everybody's got to be comfortable with it. So you need to at least, I would say, up front, have a discussion about what am I looking for in the school, and what am I looking for in the school for my son or daughter. So be open and up front, put that all out on the table. I would say, do it on the way home. Turn off the radio, make sure that they have the conversation at some point.
That's probably one of the best things about tonight, not just the information you're going to get right now or are getting, but there is a ride home. And you got to be a team. You know, and I'm sure there's already enough times where there's butting heads and you know, you don't see it the same way, and students don't see it the same way, and probably a lot of things. But for college, you know, let's kind of take the gloves off and just kind of like say, hey, we're a team, let's figure this out. This isn't easy. And while they may act like they know it, or parents may think that they know it, so much has changed for you. And students are under so much stress about everything that we probably can't relate to anymore. But we got to try, and you're living under the same roof, so really use that opportunity, a small opportunity tonight, but let that carry over into better things, because it's there, it's not going away, and if we can align, you guys can align with each other based on our experience, it's obviously a much happier place. In terms of just some follow-up on the visit piece, there are a lot of times too, if you're thinking of a school that you just can't get to, a lot of the websites now offer virtual tours, either off the actual college website themselves, or there's websites that have specialized in basically virtual tours themselves. So consider that. It's not ideal, but it's obviously better than nothing else. And then if you are and do have the opportunity to get somewhere, then you have at least a little working knowledge. I've always remembered some of the things that I was told when you do go visit a school, is always the two things are go to the career placement office to find out what are people doing with that major you're thinking. So then are they getting jobs, are they going to grad school, what's the viable options? And always pick up a school newspaper. Because while the best foot forward is always going to be going on for open house, the school newspaper never lies. And it's going to tell you all the hot stuff that's going on, just so that you have a working knowledge of that place. Take it with a grain of salt, but it is going to give you a little bit more of the, I guess, the dirt of the school.
I would also say a lot of admissions offices utilize student tour guides, student assistants, online chat. So if you can't make it to that institution, see if you can chat with a current student as well. They'll be able to give you a good perspective from the society you want to hear from.
And just like anything, they'll take everything with a grain of salt. And then the last thing on that part would be, if you haven't heard about the college fair, everything was mailed home to you. They are starting to come in terms of the field trip we're taking. But on the 16th of March, in the convention center, we're going to have 200 school, well, a national association is going to be bringing 200 colleges down to the convention center for students to visit. We're going to go on that Wednesday. The students will have an hour. We'll take a couple buses. There are buses that... number of buses we need, but they also have a session at night down at the convention center that, again, if you want to get your son or daughter to bring friends, if you're the driver, that's fine. Just the more options and the more opportunity, the better. It is also on Thursday at the convention center during the day. We don't go for that. Other schools do, but if you work downtown and you want to take some time, you can go and visit and talk to schools as well. So we've tried to establish what are the factors, what are all the things I'm looking for, what should I look for, and let's just say now we have some schools. Of course, we won't keep saying it, but Naviance is going to be huge in this whole process. But now we got to find out a little bit about the academic stuff and what goes into applying. So maybe we can just start a little bit on the transcript. That's probably the number one thing that schools will look at to determine your eligibility of acceptance. So if colleges want to just talk a little bit about the transcript and what it looks like for undergrad.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, at Geneseo, we certainly try to take as much of a holistic approach to the entire process. But when it does come to the academic side of things, the first thing that we do look at is your transcript. The first thing we're going to look at is your curriculum. What have you taken? Have you taken math? Have you taken science? Have you taken foreign language? Have you gone above and beyond? Have you challenged yourself with maybe AP credit, college credit, the IB diploma, that kind of thing. We're fortunate at Geneseo to have a pretty strong applicant pool, so we are looking for students who have gone above and beyond with regards to those things, especially if they're offered at the particular school. If a student's got a 100% GPA and they've got to take an easy street, or they've got if the student's got an 88, 89 average, who's gone above and beyond and has challenged himself, who's going to be more appealing to us? It's going to be that student who's got that lower GPA, who's gone above and beyond, because that's the student who's typically going to transition to Geneseo and be able to succeed in the classroom. So we certainly do accept AP credit with a score of 3 or above. We accept IB with a 4 or 5. We accept college credit with a C or above. So we certainly are looking for those students who have, again, gone above and beyond, challenged themselves,
and I would denote that as well. We look at a holistic approach. First, we look at your high school transcript. I want to see that you've taken your basic, your English, your math, your science, your language, your social. We want to see that if you have an area that you enjoy, you want to challenge yourself by maybe taking an AP at college level or an IB, depending on what's offered. We want to look to see what clubs and organizations you belong to. We want to also look at were they in leadership positions. Did you do community service? What things excited you? I love personally reading each and every essay that I review the file on. I get an insight to what the student's all about, and most applications will have an essay component to it. So think about when you're writing that. I encourage students also to do an activities resume. Sometimes it's not enough space on the application to fit everything, and I can tell you sometimes you forget what you did in ninth grade. So maybe use this summer to think about what direction you want to go in and getting your together. Many times colleges and universities are going to be looking for letters of recommendations. Those who are juniors, think about who you might want to have write those letters of recommendation. Get to them before they leave for summer, for the summer break. And with teacher ABC, no, Mrs. Smith, I really want you to write a letter. I know one teacher who had over 100 recommendations to write. Difficult to do in September when maybe deadlines are November, December. So, you know, think about those things ahead of time. The more you prep now or over the summer, the easier it's going to be for your office and your guys to come get that information to your schools in a very timely manner.
We do not take a holistic approach. We, as I mentioned earlier, we are an open access institution. So, but we do review the high school transcript. Now, why do we review the high school transcript? No matter what college you go to, and sometimes I get a huge sigh from students, no matter what college you go to, you will always have to take math and you will always have to take English. It's not going away, okay? But at ECC, we look to make sure that students who come are what we call college ready. So oftentimes, students, we look at the region's English score and math score, and we look to see if, make sure that students test into college level math and English, okay? If they don't, we don't get a waiver off of the transcript, then they have to take our placement test, okay? And again, the placement test is designed, before I get there, your SATs and ACTs, and I know we'll get onto that a little bit earlier, that can also waive you from the placement test as well, you know, with a certain score. But if you don't meet those, then you take the placement test at the college, and that's where we determine where students fit in math and English. Now, I will say this, that you would be surprised on the number of students who finish high school with 4 years of English and 4 years of math, who don't take placement tests and things of that nature, don't think it's like, you know, as important, and they end up testing into developmental math and English. It's happened at every single school in Western New York, looked at the data, but it's just very important and make sure you get placed in the proper courses. Oh, we also look for at the transcript to place people in honors programs, and we also have a lot of scholarships that we offer, and I know we'll probably get into scholarship conversation later on, but we look to identify students, because we have a couple of full free ride scholarships that we offer at ECC, and we look to identify candidates for that through that process as well.
What about certain programs there? Do you look for certain things?
Great question, Mr. Rizzo, yes. And I appreciate you bringing that up. Yes, we do have some competitive programs, and I apologize for not mentioning it earlier. Our nursing program is a very competitive program. Dental hygiene is very competitive. So for example, with our nursing program, the students who come into it, essentially, we do have a pathway to come right out of high school to go into nursing, but it's extremely challenging to get into that program. So oftentimes students will do 1 year in our general studies program, taking the prerequisite courses, your biology, anatomy and physiology, math and English. And the average student coming into our nursing program has about between a 3.5 and a 3.8 college GPA out of a 4.0. Pretty competitive. We have a limited number of spots. Dental hygiene is the same way, and so those are two of our more competitive. All of our health sciences programs are what we call competitive programs. In other words, there's a certain number of spots. You're going to find competitive type programs throughout all of higher education. Personally, for nursing, and I've said this many a times, I don't mind that it's extremely competitive. Because, you know, same thing with medical school. I was a medical school advisor for a long time. Because if I come across the table, I kind of want to know that you know what you're doing. So I was hoping you paid attention to anatomy and physiology. It just makes me feel better. But it's very important in terms of that piece. So I appreciate you bringing that up. So
when it comes to the different majors at Geneseo, we don't admit by major. So if you're admissible to Geneseo and you hit each of the criteria that we're looking for, you're able to be in any of the 50 plus majors that we do offer. We do have some cooperative programs that we offer. In those cases, there are some GPA requirements and some certain things we look for within a transcript. But for the actual majors that we offer at Geneseo, we're not necessarily, like I said, admitting by major.
We're reviewing it by major, so if you know a major that you're looking for, that would be the major we would like to review your application for. We do have an undeclared program, Academic Exploration, which is absolutely my favorite program. says to a student, you can be undecided or still deciding which major you want to go into. We've won national awards for the program because it works with the students to systematically look at the career clusters, look at what they enjoy doing, what they're good at doing, hopefully marrying those up, and if not, what steps does a student have to take to get what their passion is so they can move through a curriculum in a timely manner. We do have an exceptionally high graduation rate. We're one of the highest in the Western New York area. So if a student comes to us, they want to be out 4 years, that can happen. They just need to work with their advisor and take those courses, unless they're in one of our 5 or 6 year programs. But we are looking very specifically. Healthcare is really hot in Western New York right now. You'll find that they're very competitive. For our nursing program, we have over 500 applications for about 50 spots. So that being said, we are looking for top students coming into the program. We'll have a wait list very early. And in some of the other programs, there'll be that, but later on down the road, the nursing will fill up very, very quickly. So we encourage early applications, taking your SATs in your junior year, so if you need to repeat them senior year, you can do that early enough so we get to the wait list scenario. We do require chemistry for nursing, as we do for all our pre-med, pre-med, and the biology and the science-based major. So it might not be required for your high school, but it is required for us for those programs.
I would say based on, and you know, the Western New York example of having all different types of colleges and universities was something that's a big key to understand. But also is that as much as we've heard 3 different types of policies for admittance into certain academic programs, your counseling staff here at Clarence is phenomenal, and they know those. They know those nuances. Okay, so if you're applying engineering at UB, they know what it takes and what criteria they're going to be looking at versus, you know, just psychology at UB and, you know, school of management. So definitely, out of all of this, and I'll say this many times, utilize your resources, utilize the parents for the car ride home, but definitely utilize the counseling office here because they are one of the best in Western New York as an entire department, and they're the ones who are going to be able to have the answer for you. You know, there's lots of networking opportunities for counselors to work with colleges and universities. There is always a Clarence representative there. I mean, there's a meeting tomorrow morning at, you know, ECC with counselors, principals from all throughout Western New York. I know there'll be people here from Clarence there, and they're getting information so they can provide it back to you. So utilize those resources, make the appointments, start early.
I think Mr. Gardner, the president of the Western New York School Counselors Association, will be there tomorrow. Is that
yes? Yes. I did want to say, I apologize, Eric was supposed to say all that at 8 o'clock. That was according to our plan.
Oh, I didn't read through the agenda, sorry.
I do want to say, though, in terms of the counselors, yes, you know, we've done this, I think, long enough that when we talk about the transcript, the resume, the essays, a lot of the stuff Chris alluded to, that may sound like, holy cow, how are you? That's all kind of what we sort of call is in our wheelhouse. We know exactly what we want students to do. I can honestly say, but I've worked along with these guys so long, that's what we do. That's what we feel very passionate about. So, you know, your goal is our goal kind of thing, and none of this maybe new to you is really new to us. So we get excited to kind of start our sort of new batch of juniors to do all this. But just remember, too, with the schools that are mentioned, just like we're presenting to an audience of, let's say, 125 students, we have 300, well, about 350 juniors. Everyone's so different. So we're kind of giving a flavor of what's out there. And then when we meet individually, it becomes very individual. Just like the schools, what Geneseo says versus what Niagara and ECC, and if we've had as many schools, they all have different thoughts, requirements, goals. It's just the way it is. And our job is to try to help with all of that. But the thing that has always stuck with me is the stats that I have heard were 50% of colleges. So if we said 5,000 exist, 2,500 schools will accept at least 3/4 of students that apply. So that's majority of students are going to get in places. And then 75% of the schools are going to accept at least half of the students that apply. So while you may see in the paper all of these crazy statistics of who doesn't get in, the majority of students do get in. And I will say Clarence students have a very good and favorable record, depending. keep that in mind. That kind of, I hope, mellows it. We live this, so not a lot phases us, but I can only imagine if you didn't live it like we do, that it's kind of crazy mode, and we just don't want that. We really want to settle it down, and a lot of the kind of wholesome points we're making sound hokey, but they're really true. You know, be happy, like your major. Find a place that you're going to be confident. Doesn't sound, I didn't read anything like that. All I hear is they accept 6%. So try to just kind of, if you can, calm it all down, and I think the whole experience, the relationship, everything will go much better. We didn't really touch upon, well, in terms of the transcript, the resume, the essays, those are some of the requirements. SATs and ACTs, maybe the counselors can touch upon that piece of where they fit in and kind of our approach with our students.
There's never been a better time to take the ACT. Essentially, there, as most of you probably know, the SAT is being revamped, and this March is going to be the first demonstration of the new SAT. I know that some of you have taken the old SAT to kind of get that score underneath your belt. There's a lot of high promises that College Board is making about the new SAT and stating that it's going to be properly normed and all that kind of stuff. And I think that in large part they're probably going to be able to do a lot of that. However, there's just a big feeling of uncertainty out there, which is why we've always recommended that students take both the SAT and the ACT. Colleges will take one. The overwhelming majority of schools will accept the higher of the two scores. They'll take the higher of the two scores. If you do better on one than the other, they've got a concordance table, they're going to give you the benefit of the doubt and take the higher score. So we've always encouraged you to take both, but because of the uncertainty surrounding the new SAT, we really recommend that you take the ACT as well. The writing section is optional for both the SAT and the ACT. And what I'd say regarding the writing section is, you know what, take at least one of them so that you're kind of covered, all right? Most schools are not requiring it. In fact, I think the official stance on College Board for the website, the school's official stance for the writing on the new SAT is neither require nor recommend. However, there are some schools that do require it. Brockport is recommending it. Binghamton is recommending it. So there's enough schools that are going to be sort of in your pool of potential schools that if they're recommending it, you probably want to have it. Recommended generally, in my estimation, means mandatory. So I'd say make sure that you take at least the ACT or the SAT with the writing section. The Khan Academy is something that is a very good resource for planning and preparing for the new SAT, and it's a partnership that College Board has with the SAT, or with the College Board has with Khan Academy, and it's a free resource. It's got a lot of really good information. So while yes, it can be beneficial to pay a lot of money for some of the test prep stuff that's out there, that can definitely be helpful. And for some students, they might need that. You might need to. I'm not saying you have to, but for some students, you might need to spend money on a course and have them go and sit someplace for an hour every single week for the 6-8 weeks leading up to the test. They might need that structure. But for some other students, if they are able to sit a couple of times a week for a half an hour and just work on the Khan Academy, that can be maybe, I don't know, 80-90% of the preparation for the test at 0% of the cost. So it's definitely up to you guys, and you've got to weigh the pros and cons of the different prep methods that are out there, but there's a lot of different ways to approach it, I would say. But you definitely do want to do a little bit of prep ahead of time for both tests. And like I said, definitely take both tests. It's going to be offered on March here? March 5th. It's going to be on March 5th. And then the ACT is going to be on April 9th. Here at Clarence High School. You do not have to take the test here at Clarence. You can try and figure out what is going to be the best testing environment for you. We test in the gym, so if you're somebody that would prefer a small group environment, Williamsville tests in smaller classrooms. So if that's going to be a better test environment for you, then maybe you might want to test there. If you get distracted from the gym or distracted because your friends are around you, you might want to look at some alternatives to testing. But yeah, you can test wherever, but we offer the test. The SAT here in March and in May, and we offer the ACT in April, and then again in the fall. I would strongly suggest taking the SAT not once, but at least twice, once in the spring and once in the fall of your senior year. Yes?
We talk about the timeline for testing, and it's been pretty static for years, but there have been some changes in financial aid, especially with colleges. So at this point, rather than hammer home what we think is the best timeline for kids, I'd like to ask you guys, if I could, how you see things playing out with the changes that have happened, and if you still recommend that they can take an ACT or an SAT again in the fall and have that be a part of the application process, or if the changes have pushed things up and that needs to be done now. Can you guys elaborate on that a little bit if possible?
Chris, if you can also just maybe introduce what the changes are and then how SATs are affected by that? Under the financial aid piece?
Yeah, financial aid changes. The prior is going to be introduced for those students who are juniors here, which means you can go back to 2015 and perhaps they're going to be looking at. How is that affecting our timeline? Because you guys can apply for financial aid earlier at Niagara. It's only going to be affecting the timeline of the students who are already enrolled. So our freshmen, this year's freshman class, will do the prior as early as October if they want to, and we may be able to work with them more quickly. For students who are juniors, our financial aid timeline will change because we need those SATs, those ACTs. For our top students who are recipients of our trustee scholarships, we have scholarship competitions that will be placed into your financial aid package. So to do your financial aid package much earlier than what we're doing it now, we'll roll out our first financial aid packages March 1st, so they'll be coming out very soon. So it still gives you a few months before that May 1st deadline. So you can have it in and you can complete it and get it done. For Niagara, though, you're probably not receiving your financial aid package any earlier than that March 1st week, because we want to look at all the different scholarships that we offer competitively. We have a new SURF grant. We have a number of different things that we want to give students the best opportunity. Some of those are SAT and ACT sensitive, so if you need to repeat that for the January time and you receive it by then, we can still get you into the competitions. And
it's going to work that way for us this year. Yeah, we're very much aligned.
I just met on that today. I think, I can envision probably everything's going well. It's almost 8, and then we got to throw this at you. And it's like, oh, I just was getting it. So again, it gets a little bit more complicated, so to speak, but it's really only complicated, I think, if you've had a son or daughter that has already gone to college. All it means is really the taxes that you're filling out right now, you can use those in October, where if you had never done this before, you were having to wait till next year's taxes. Well, you know when we get those, it's never as quick as we want, so it would always, I think, just drive everybody crazy because you had to underestimate or you had to wait. So it's really a good thing, and I think especially good if the colleges don't change a thing on their end. So don't let that conversation that we just had get you worried at all.
The other good news is for every college and university, we're supposed to have on our websites, and I'm sure all of us do, what they call a net cost calculator. And you can go on that, you can plug in your financial information, and we will come back with what we call an estimated financial aid package. So you can still find out a little bit ahead of time what things might look at the schools that you're looking at. But they are estimates, and we need what you're going to be working on. Your actual income tax, because it's going to be completed, or there's some good news there. But if you have questions about that, all of our financial aid offices are available to answer any questions that you might have.
We just set the date today. Our financial aid night for the fall is actually going to be a little bit earlier than usual. In the past, we've had it in November because the financial aid, the opening date for financial aid used to be January 2nd. Now it's going to be October 2nd because you're going to be able to use 2015 instead of 2016 for your W-2s and earnings information. So we're going to be doing it a little bit earlier to respond to that October 1st opening date, and it's going to be September 27th. September 27th is going to be our financial aid night. It's going to be here at 7 o'clock.
And I would say just keep in mind, even though these admissions people represent their school, they're always able to, you know, if you connect or you just want information, it doesn't have to be about Niagara or Geneseo or ACC, call them. And we call on them all the time. And the same with financial aid. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to go to that school. If you have any connections, any relationships, or you're just not sure, most we have connections at a lot of the schools too, where they'll just help us because, you know, there's a question at hand.
One thing about SAT and ACT that I did not mention, and I definitely should have, when you register for the tests, they're going to give you four. I hesitate to say free because it's basically free with, you know, with the price of registration, but basically they'll give you four schools that you can send your scores to. Most schools require that the test scores come directly from the testing institution, meaning SAT and ACT. So even if you don't know where you're applying, just put the four schools down, because if you wait until afterwards, you're going to have to pay extra to send the scores directly to those schools. So you can send it before for free right up front, but if it's after you've already taken the test, you can't go back and get those four for free anymore. You have to pay, I think it's like $11 per school that you want to send them to. And that can get a little bit pricey. So make sure that you take advantage of that, and make sure that you do send the scores to the colleges. Because even if you're not sure that you're going to apply there, they're not going to take a look at the score and say, oh, this person is absolutely not qualified to laugh. It doesn't work like that at all. So I would definitely say make sure that you send the scores up front.
I just want to jump in, because I haven't spoken in like 5 minutes. But one of the most important things you want to do is be mindful of deadlines, okay? But also plan on being early, okay? Is this more true of scholarships? All colleges and universities have some form of scholarships, but they are finite or limited funds, okay? I've been in places where you could have a student who's valedictorian apply for a school in March, and they get $0, where had they applied back in November, and the counselors have seen it, they could probably name students off the top of their head, but they, had they applied in October or November, not only would the college look at their financial aid in place, had they done that early enough, they might have had a pretty sizable scholarship to help defray the cost of that institution, okay? So please be mindful of deadlines. And a lot of schools have rolling admissions, which means there's no application deadline, but their scholarships for consideration do have deadlines. Some may be December 31st, some may be earlier. Again, utilize your resources, all aspects of resources. When you're going to the college fair, oh, do you have scholarships? Okay, well, when's the deadline to make sure I have to apply by? Okay, is there a separate application for scholarships? Very important questions, okay? But apply early. As juniors, your application should be done into the counseling office. I used to say November 17th because that was an awesome day, my birthday. But honestly, by November 1st, you know, even mid-October, get things wrapped up, letters of recommendation, get them done prior to heading out for summer break. You know, I mean, I'd want a letter of recommendation from this guy, but I'm sure 100 other people do. And, you know, by the time he gets to, you know, number 99, you want to be the first one, because that's when the passion and everything is in there, okay?
You know, piggybacking on that, a couple quick points. You know, you talk about scholarships, and SAT and ACT scores definitely play a role in that. So just because you might have gotten a test score that you know will get you into a college, you might be a couple of points away from another scholarship threshold. So try and make sure you look at the school's website and find out. A lot of them will post what sort of the scholarship threshold numbers are for SAT and ACT. And if you're a couple of points away, definitely take the SAT or ACT again to try and hit that cut point. Then the other thing, as far as applying early, and I don't know if we're starting to segue into the actual application process, the common application is, we have a very love-hate relationship with it. There's a lot of good things about the Common Act and a lot of bad things about the Common Act. However, one of the really good things is this year, beginning this year, you can start the Common Act, I believe, right now as a junior, and it will roll over into your senior year. It used to be the type of thing where they would roll over, and anybody that had started it 1 year, it would be wiped out as of August 1st. And so you'd have to start it over again on August August 1st. If you start it right now, this is your Common App that you can take right through until you actually click the submit button in November, December, whatever it might be. So that is a way to kind of get a jump. And I would recommend, if you're going to apply to a lot of schools and you're going to apply to schools that might all take the Common App, but some of them might be SUNY schools, some of them might be private schools, the Common App might be the way to go. It's okay to get in and play around with it. So much of this process can be very daunting, can be very scary, because you do it once. I know that's Mr. Gardner's kind of tagline. You do it once, and you want to make sure that you get it right. There's a lot of anxiety surrounding that. However, if you get in, you play around with it a little bit, it's kind of like you're playing in the sandbox. You're going to get used to seeing what it's asking you, and it's going to be a little bit more familiar. Once it's familiar, it's not nearly as scary. Once you're into it. So I think that's not a bad thing to do, is at least start by creating a Common App account and just look around on that as to what you're going to need to provide.
You want to, Mr. Steger, just talk about the different applications that do exist? Now that we kind of have all the criteria, we kind of know where we want to apply, which applications should be used, with what help?
Sure. There are three major applications that our students will use depending on where they're applying. How many schools they're applying is the Common App that Mr. Rizzo mentioned, which is one common application that applies to hundreds and hundreds of schools. So for some students, if they're applying to seven or eight colleges and all of those colleges are on the Common App, it makes sense to just fill out that one application and save themselves some time and some energy and kind of cover everything with one application. Each individual school, for the most part, will also have their own application. Some schools will have a school application and the Common application, so you have options there. Because sometimes, even if some of your schools are on the Common application, it's not the best option for you to do just because of everything that goes into the Common App. It is the most intensive of the applications, kind of by far, but it can still be easier than doing six or seven different applications. So that's a conversation a lot of times that kids need to have with us as a counselor, but we can maybe save you some time, save you some energy. If you like writing six or seven essays as opposed to one or two, then by all means, kind of make that decision on your own, but that can be something where we can help you kind of streamline things a little bit. And then for State University of New York schools, the SUNYs, there's a SUNY application that covers all of the SUNY schools, including ECC and Geneseo. However, for ECC, you're much better off to use their school application because that is free, as opposed to having to pay $50 for the SUNY app. So there is some researching that goes into figuring out which applications, some conversation with counselors where we can help kind of steer you in the right direction and maybe save you some time and make things a little bit easier for you.
Again, if that's foreign to you, again, something that we're very comfortable doing, again, just one more thing to kind of have to worry about and ask, but it's definitely something that we'll be taking care of. You know, a couple of things as we kind of get some maybe closing thoughts too going. We talked a little bit about testing, you know, a lot of kind of mixed messages, but I'm definitely not a proponent of the testing prep. I don't necessarily think, especially now that Khan Academy has really come on board, that's a free test prep online course. Again, I think what's out there is any need that somebody senses, somebody needs, they're gonna kind of ask you and do and provide for you for that. And testing prep, as you know, SATs and ACTs, it took us a good hour before we started talking about that. They are not the be-all end-all, okay? Transcript, day-to-day work ethic, that's to me still the number one, and I'd like to think the colleges would agree, where that says much more than a three-hour test. But as we all know, it's out there. But again, I'm not a big proponent of the cost of these test preps, just like the college aides and people that are going to say, I'm going to help you get into these schools. I think these colleges, and I'll let them talk, they're not able, nobody has conversations with these admissions people helping them get in. I'd like to think that our relationship over 4 years, that we are probably the best suited along with your help. So don't necessarily get panicky and thinking, oh, all this, all these friends, all everyone's talking about getting this help. I just don't think that is needed along with athletics. Nobody's going to help you get that scholarship. I have not found that. They're going to help you maybe send videos. They're going to do things that I think you're perfectly capable of doing. Greg Kaczynski has been a big asset to us. You know, all of us have kind of experience in that realm. We can do that for you. So again, I feel like you're ripe for people to kind of prey on your naivete, and I'm hoping to kind of say use us as that source. But if colleges want to speak to that at all on any of those regards.
I would say definitely go to your guidance office first, because they're going to be the ones who are going to connect with you. Trust me, they will call us if there's an issue, but we call them if we have an application that we need more information on. We're calling them. It's a two-way street with the guidance office. It needs to happen that way. They should be your first stop before you do anything else. The college preps for the testing, SATs, ACTs, I look at that, I would agree. I don't think they're necessary, but I know some students really feel that they want to do that, and that's a family decision. It's, you know, something we at Niagara, we want to see competency on the SATs and ACTs. And what do we mean by that? We'd like to see close to 1,000 critical reading and math. We want to see around a 21 or a 22 on the ACT for most majors. Nursing is our exception to the rule. But we're looking for that, but we are going to go to your high school transcript first. We're going to look to see those courses that we talked about before. We want to make sure that is a solid academic background, so you have the propensity to get through a rigorous academic program for your school.
At Geneseo, as I mentioned earlier, we certainly do look at everything. And obviously the transcript and the curriculum is imperative in our decision, but test scores certainly do play a role as well. My job as an admissions counselor, I believe, is to get those students to Geneseo that want to be at Geneseo. One of the areas that I can help students out with is test scores. I mentioned it here already. But at the end of the day, I don't care how many times a student takes an SAT or ACT. At the end of the day, I'm going to take your best combined math and critical reading scores, even if that means you've taken it three times. New at Geneseo a few years ago, we now super score the ACT. That used to be if you took the ACT twice, you just took the best composite score. Now we go in, we take the best of each component to calculate the composite score. If you struggle with the SAT, but you do well on the ACT, I don't care about the SAT. I'll circle on the ACT or vice versa. Whatever is going to benefit you as a student and give you the best opportunity to get to Geneseo, that's ultimately what I'm going to do. But because of the strength of our applicant pool, for us, we need to make sure we're admitting students that hit each of the areas that we're looking for. So most importantly, the who you are side of things, the high school curriculum, the GPA, and then, like I said, the test scores. Something else I'm a huge believer in, I think it kind of piggybacks off this a little bit. I used to work with international students for about 3 years, implemented fall and spring orientation programming. And I give international students 2 words on the very first day of orientation that would allow them to be successful, not only their transition to the United States, but their transition to Geneseo, their time in Geneseo in life. I think these 2 words hold true for you guys. You can start with your college search process, your transition to whatever school it is that you choose, your time in that institution in life, and those 2 words are personal initiative. Okay. 80% of my phone calls and emails on a daily basis are from who? Parents, all right? Who's the one applying? Students, right? Don't get me wrong, parents, that's what we're here for, is to put your minds at ease, to answer your questions. You're making a big investment. We want to be there for you. I can't tell you how refreshing it is to receive a phone call or an email from a student themselves, a student who's been willing to go above and beyond, take ownership of their own application process. It's as simple as, you know, they pick up the phone a week after they apply and say, hey, Chris, you know, I applied a week ago, we made a connection, is my application complete? All right, that starts a little bit of dialogue. I call that name recognition. We don't require interviews at Geneseo as part of our application process, but if Geneseo is one of your final schools, the first one to tell you it's never a bad thing to request one, okay? I don't sit there and grill you with questions like some institutions. My idea of an interview is much like my philosophy of a visit. By the time you leave my office, by the time you leave our campus, your questions, in some cases your remaining questions have been answered, and you leave having a better sense of whether or not Geneseo is the right fit for you, all right? I call that putting a face to a name, all right? Please take that for what it's worth. But students, we want to hear from you, all right? Our job is to make sure we get those students to our institutions, and we want to work with you as you move forward, above and beyond just the wonderful group that you have here at Clarence.
You know, along those lines that we didn't mention is we get probably maybe 300 colleges will come to our school in the fall, typically in the fall, for seniors to kind of meet with. So when Geneseo comes, what he's kind of alluding to, Chris, is when you come down, you're going to kind of meet him and you're going to kind of develop a relationship, and that's kind of how it all goes. And it's kind of in coin demonstrated interest, but you're kind of showing an interest. You know, with the way of these applications, schools don't know who's really sincere They may apply, but we don't know, they don't know how sincere students are. And they would like to offer an acceptance of somebody that's actually going to go there so that they kind of know. So the more relationships you have through email, through personal, that's definitely an advantage to you and definitely a natural in terms of getting information.
I just want to mention a couple of things, you know, part of the conversation. And I'm kind of going back to a couple of things in terms of deadlines. For those who are interested in any of the performing arts, some of the performing arts institutions do have auditions. And, you know, especially at different locations, be mindful of those deadlines as well. And again, your counselors can help you to get that. I think one of the most important themes that, especially from this table over here, and a colleague of mine who's a really good friend of mine used to say this, is that we are, and this is why we love our jobs, we're in the yes business. We want every, we're gonna look for every single opportunity to try to say yes, to provide an avenue for that student to come to our institution, okay? So just think about it that way. Help give us a reason yes, have those conversations. Students have those conversations with us as professionals, and you know, parents, support them along the way, ask kind of the tough questions, but students really take advantage of the component. I mean, realistically, if you screw this decision up, I mean, you're in trouble for the rest of your life. No, I'm just kidding. It's not like that, all right? This can be a fun process, you know? This can be, and this should be a fun process, and this should be one that brings you together as a family, that, you know, you're going to be enjoying this. All right, so look at it as that. It's an amazing opportunity to pick an institution. It's not, you're not gonna make the wrong decision. You follow your heart, guys, go with your gut. You know, follow your heart and talk about it, make that decision. It will be something that will be rewarding for you.
Why don't we open it up to any questions? And we can start now.
In Niagara, but there are some schools that are going to try to squeeze things, and they are going to try to package much sooner. So we're I think everybody on the admission side and the high school side, we're all going to be very interested to see how this year kind of plays out, because it could move things up for some students, or many students, it could have little to no effect.
Questions seem to scare people off, so I'm going to say one thing, because I think it's important, and then maybe everyone else will give their last shots, and then if we want questions. The one thing I do want to say, and we alluded to, there's so many Western New York schools. I want you to consider, because so many of my students, our students, will go, and oftentimes they will say, I'm going to commute, I'm going to drive back and forth, and I'm going to get a car. And I want you to really think clear. I really feel dorming is such a big part of the college experience. And I really feel like I always do, but it's like when faced with the dilemma of, do you want a car or do you want to live with a stranger, most students will pick the car. And of course, what happens is they drive back and forth to their school for 4 years, and they get a degree. But what has happened is they've never really had the college experience. And no offense to the friends they have, they keep all the same friends, they eat at all the same places, and nothing really has changed. And I do feel like, in hindsight, they would have done it differently. But the world we live in now is so instant and short-sighted that I really would say that if you as parents and sons and daughters could consider, I really feel like dorming is a key and a big part of the college experience when financially feasible. But sometimes it's instantly, well, why would I do that? I can do this. Yes, it's very convenient. But all of a sudden, you've come and gone and your 4 years are not like anybody else that maybe has dormed. It's very challenging to commute back and forth and to kind of acclimate yourself to that campus. Not impossible, but very difficult. So just something I would want you to consider that you can come out. But if anybody has any parting things that they feel they want to say before, any question? It's unlimited.
Just to kind of address that last question, yes, you can take tests as many times as you want. I would never ever do that. I would never take, because what ends up happening is that students often get frustrated or they know what's coming, and then what I've seen, and I've seen students try to increase their score to get scholarships, and this is part of what my research was on, is that after usually the third examination, scores start to dip. Because you know it's 7 o'clock in the morning on Saturday, you know it's gonna be 3 hours of pure joy. And you're just not looking forward to, let me just get this done and hope. The passion runs out for that, and then the scores come down, and then students kind of get frustrated. So, thinking about it strategically, and again, this kind of feeds into my part of work, which I said already, but I'll say it again, utilizing your resources and working with the school counselor is really gonna help with that. I mean, I've seen students take tests like SAT 6 times, and at the time they throw their hands up, I'm getting dumber, they think. It's no, you're not, you're getting bored, You're doing the same thing over and over and over again, and you're expecting a different result. And, even the passion has to be there, but definitely work with the counseling department, the counselors here, because they're going to point you in the right direction, and they'll be able to pull the shoe and say, okay, 6, 8 is enough, But really, I used to say, take my rule of thumb, which is very similar before, take each one once, and then whichever one you found more comfortable, because they're different styles of testing between ACT and SAT, take that one again, the one you like better again, okay? So that was always my rule of thumb, but again, everybody has their own opinion, so just wanted to put that out.
One quick practical tip that I would say is, like Erica said, this could be a very fun process and really a process for self-discovery for the students who you guys take it real seriously. But certainly we know there can be a lot of anxiety surrounding it. It can be something that causes you guys to butt heads a little bit with your parents, all right, in the fall. During the application process, hey, have you gotten that application done yet? Have you gotten that essay done yet? Have you gotten this done? Yeah, I got it. And there can be a lot of headbutting that goes back and forth with this. What I'd say is set a meeting, a weekly meeting, and don't talk about it other than that weekly meeting, all right? If it becomes necessary, all right? Where, the student's gonna do their piece, they're gonna work on it throughout the week, and then in the weekly meeting, we're gonna kind of assess what's happened, where are you at, where are you going, what do you need to do, and bundle it all up into that meeting. That way it's not constantly hanging over everyone's head. That can be a nice way to, from what I've found with my students, to kind of compartmentalize it and make sure that everybody's nerves are not frayed all the time, just for that, you know, meeting or whatever.
The perspective and the approach you take to this process, I think, are extremely important. If you look at it as a life or death situation, if you try to put so much pressure on your 17-year-old to say that what happens when you're 55 depends on this visit right now, this interview, then make sure when you take that visit, you check out their counseling center and their psychiatric services. It needs to be fun. It needs to be about what's the best fit for you. This isn't like love, like your mom and dad found each other. There's more than one school for everyone. You can be successful at different places and in different settings. It's about you and what can enhance what you bring to the table most. So try to approach it with that and not with the stress and the fear and the concern. Take that better approach to it. And taking up a lot of your time, I know most of you want to get home and live tweet scandal. So we'll try to get you guys out of here. I think we had a quick wrap-up question or last, you know, parting idea from the crowd. My legs are numb, so.
Okay, thank you.